I talk about verifying Casper. Casper is the brand, the name of the brand proof of stake protocol that Ethereum will be using. It's also a name of a research group doing designing the protocol. It's been changing. Maybe it will change. And as you will learn soon, and there are multiple versions of Casper, I'm talking about my best guess at the moment of the first Casper that will be deployed on the main chain. There will be a Casper contract on each fork of the Ethereum network. There will be validators, and the validators will deposit on the Casper contract. The validators vote for blocks, and the Casper contract keeps track of who voted for what and decides which block is finalized. When the validators do it correctly, they get rewards. When they make mistakes, their deposits are gone. It's called, so we call these validators slashed when their deposits are taken away. And everything in this talk after this slide will be seen by one of the Casper contracts. In my wardrobe, this Senegalian clothes is the best approximation of this Casper idea. Although this Senegal clothes works very nicely with the climate here, a validator can vote for blocks, so the voting message contains an epoch. An epoch is a number like 104, a hash of the block that's being voted for, and another number that's called the source of the vote, which is used as a justification for the vote. So, I will be drawing lots of boxes and lines in this slide deck. These picture the blockchains, and the block at the top is the newest, at the bottom is the oldest. When there are forks, this looks like trees growing from the bottom to top. There are rules for validators. The validators cannot do certain things. They are not, otherwise they will be slashed. One rule says no double voting. When a validator votes for two different blocks on the same epoch, Eve's deposits are gone, Eve is slashed. It's kind of intuitive. You cannot support two different things. You cannot contradict yourself. The rule is a bit more strict because even when you are supporting the same block multiple times, when you cite different sources, you are also slashed. This is not really intuitive why this is a bad thing to do, but this rule will be useful for preventing forks. We will see that later. Maybe an even more unintuitive rule is the no surrounding rule. When you vote for the newest block, citing the oldest block, and when you sign another voting message about something in the middle, measured by the larger, smaller epoch, your deposits are also gone. So maybe an intuitive explanation would go like your knowledge should get better and better when you learn about the cited source blocks. In this picture, after learning some newer sources, your estimate is suddenly shorter, and that's not good. But these rules are nice because it's your sole responsibility. You can be just careful not to sign contradicting messages to avoid being slashed. In the previous versions of the Casper protocol, some slashing rules depended on other people's behavior. Depending on other people's behavior, your actions are suddenly slashable. That happened in the previous versions, but now that's not the case. You have to be careful, but if you are careful, you can avoid being slashed. But after that, after talking about slashing, we can forget about individual validators. We can measure the weight of votes by the amount of deposits backing up the vote. We can say X is a backed vote, and we can also just add voting messages by the amount of Ether backing up the claims. So when there's a next Ether vote and a Y Ether vote, we can add these up and we can say X plus Y Ether vote. In the protocol, two-thirds vote plays an important role. This says two-thirds of the total deposits made by all validators backs up the claim of this voting. We will be talking about justified blocks. There will be a single genesis block that everybody knows. The genesis block is justified. And when there is a two-third vote, so citing a justified block, and the voted for block is also justified. So we draw links along the two-third votes, and when a block is connected to the genesis block, it's justified. There's a stronger condition called finalized. Only a justified block can be finalized when there's a vote involving two blocks, just a direct parent and a direct child. The cited justified block becomes finalized. In this picture, the block at the bottom gets finalized. And with these rules, I have been laying out the definitions for stating a theorem. The theorem says if finalized blocks fork, there must be one-third of the validators being slashed, measured by the amount of the deposits. So, well, I talked with somebody this morning, and he said it doesn't make sense to go into the mathematics for this big audience, but I will try to disprove that claim. Well, it's not fair because I'm not talking about the case NAC, I'm talking about a much simpler piece of mathematics. So my assumption here is, well, okay, if there are two finalized blocks not on the same chain, we have a fork, then my goal here is to find one-third of validators slashed. The name of the theorem is called accountable safety. The word accountable comes from the fact that you can find one-third of validators to blame. They are responsible, they are accountable for the fork. Now, okay, well, there are two blocks finalized at epoch V1 and V2. These two epochs might be equal or not, V1 equal V2, or V1 is not equal to V2. Can be either case, so I have to do proofs for both cases. The easier case is V1 equals to V2. Now you see some bees. Basically, I'm supposed to follow the bees, and the bees guide me through the proof, and I should be able to explain this through. So the assumption is these blocks are finalized. Blocks are finalized when there are votes involving direct child and the direct parent with this shape. We have finalized the blocks not on the same chain. So in particular, these are not the same. And I didn't say that, I didn't spell this out, but each block can uniquely identify the parent block. This means this not equal can move upwards. So there are two child blocks. There are two different child blocks being voted for by 2/3 of the validators. 2/3 did that. 2/3 did this. So at least 1/3 did both of these voting. And there was a rule against this. You cannot vote for two different blocks at the same epoch. These 1/3 validators are now slashed. Now we are happy with this case. The other case was when V1 is not equal to V2. Maybe V1 is, so one is bigger than the other. But here in this picture, the left hand side and right hand side, there's a symmetry, V1 and V2. You can swap V1 and V2 and get really similar picture. I can shout without loss of generality, and with this spell, I'm allowed to talk only about one case because the other case is really symmetric, the same argument again. So V1 is bigger than V2. We were talking about two blocks not on the same chain, but I changed it a little bit. H1 is not a descendant of H2. This change of words, this paraphrasing, no, it's not really paraphrasing, it's a little bit weakening the assumption. It's useful for the proof. This way I can prove it. But when I kept talking about two blocks not on the same chain, I cannot complete the proof. H1 is finalized, and in particular, it has to be, okay, well, when it's finalized, it has to be justified as well. Again, I'm weakening the conditions. I'm preparing for something. I'm preparing for a mathematical induction. So basically, I repeat similar proofs again and again. When the difference of epochs is 1, 2, 3, 4, I repeat the proofs. And then now I ask, oh, what about 6? What about 7? And so on. But in each case, I can assume everything previous, all previous cases are solved already. So now, yes, I'm just showing the same picture as before. So H1, block H1 is justified. There are two cases. H1 can be at the genesis block, or there can be voting involving a source, again justified. H1 cannot be the genesis because, oh, okay, well, genesis has to be at epoch 0. I forgot to say that. Theorem provers prevent me from doing these mistakes, but when I'm making slides, it doesn't. And then, so H1 is not a genesis, so there must be a voting involving a source justified. It's called J here. J is justified at epoch pre. This pre can be larger than V2, equal to V2, or smaller than V2. When pre is bigger than V2, J and H2 we can compare this J and H2. H2 and H1 are in ancestor descendant relation. No, not in ancestor descendant relation. H1 and J are in ancestor and descendant relation. So these two blocks, J and H2, are different. Moreover, J and H2 are not in ancestor descendant relation because if J is a descendant of H2, well, H1 is a descendant of J, so and a descendant of a descendant is again a descendant, so that contradicts. So, well, we have now it looks like H1 and J are really similar, and that's the case. Actually, J has all the property I assumed for H1, and here I can use the previous case of the mathematical induction because it's a simpler case because J is older than H1. This is a simpler case. I've already proved that in the previous incarnations, then it's gone. The next case is when this pre-epoch is equal to V2. This one is rather easy because we have a justified block and a finalized block at the same epoch, and when two blocks are justified, two different blocks are justified on the same epoch, we can repeat the arguments and we can say one third of the validators are slashed. Maybe the most interesting case is when this pre-epoch is smaller than V2. So here the justification chain kind of skips over V2. Well, not necessarily because this H1 and so this epoch V1 might be well equal to or different from V2 plus one. When V1 is bigger than V2 plus one, it's easy because well the picture really looks like the no surrounding rule. And well, two thirds did this and two thirds did that. So at least one third did both, and this one third violated this no surrounding rule. Well, this way I'm proving a theorem, and at the same time I'm showing that these slashing rules are useful. Without the no surrounding rule, in this case, the main network could fork, and that would be a disaster, but because of this no surrounding rule, we can at least hold one third of the validators accountable for the fork. The last case in the proof is when V1 is exactly one more than V2. This is again an easier case because we have two different blocks at the same epoch being justified, and in this case, at least one third of the validators voted for two different blocks on the same epoch, so this one third can be held accountable. And the nice thing is that in all cases, the Casper contract is able to identify who is to blame and get their deposits taken away. Before making these slides, I checked my arguments against a theorem prover called Isabel Hall, and well, I chose to display the proofs to you because well, just explaining what is a proof, what is mathematics, what is Gentian natural deduction conceptually, maybe just displaying the proofs like this would tell you a better idea what I'm doing, I thought. The Casper protocol is changing, so I have to catch up, and I'm actually in the middle of catching up. Not only the safety, I have to prove the liveness, so the protocol does not get stuck. I also need to talk about when validators are changing, what happens. The proofs will get a little bit more complicated, but I'm confident I can finish those. Okay, well, my time is running up. I have to finish the talk as well. Thank you.